Astronauts stranded in space hoping for a Hollywood happy ending to their terrifying journey. Three crew members of the International Space Station may not be able to return home due to damage to a Russian spacecraft. After their spacecraft sustained severe damage, a group of astronauts are stranded in orbit around the Earth. They can be sent back home on a rescue ship, but there is a problem. Seven people cannot fit in its four seats, which are the only ones it has. It sounds like the suspenseful storyline of a Hollywood movie to compete with the struggles of Bruce Willis in Armageddon, or George Clooney and Sandra Bullock in Gravity. What exactly happened, and how will SpaceX rescue all seven despite the limitation? Let's find out. Hello everyone, welcome back to Elon Musk Evolution, where we bring you the most recent news about Elon Musk and his multi-billion-dollar companies, space news, and the latest science and technology. But before we begin, make sure you subscribe to our channel and click the bell icon so you don't miss any of our amazing videos. After a Russian Soyuz spacecraft experienced a coolant leak in mid-December, NASA may turn to its commercial partner SpaceX to fly three people down to Earth. NASA said in a blog post on Friday that it had reached out to SpaceX about its capability to return additional crew members aboard Dragon if needed in an emergency. Currently, NASA is looking into whether or not the Soyuz spacecraft would still be able to transport astronauts on the journey back from the ISS, the space agency added. This is a major challenge that astronauts on the ISS may encounter after a Russian Soyuz capsule sustained damage that may be too great to be repaired. The Soyuz spacecraft carrying NASA astronaut Frank Rubio, Russian cosmonauts Dmitry Petelin and Sergei Prokopyev, and two other crew members was used to transport them to the ISS in September. A significant coolant leak that the Soyuz experienced 2 weeks ago while parked at the ISS has led some experts to conclude that it is no longer capable of flying safely. The only other spacecraft in orbit is an American SpaceX Dragon that arrived at the ISS in October with a crew of four astronauts, including two from NASA, a Canadian, and a Russian. Preparing an escape plan. This crew could escape in the Dragon in the event that the ISS needs to be evacuated. However, there would be no escape for the remaining three. Roscosmos, the Russian space agency, is still determining the degree of the Soyuz's damage as well as its potential origin. With temperatures within the capsule already rising, video recorded on December 14 showed coolant leaking from the ship into the vacuum of space via a hole in the pipe that was less than a millimeter wide. The damage is believed to have been caused by a micrometeorite or a very small piece of space junk. In either case, there are considerable dangers involved in operating the ship during re-entry. The Soyuz is deemed useless in the opinion of Tommaso Scoba, a former executive in charge of space flight safety at the European Space Agency. As he stated on the website space.com, "I have to assume that the Soyuz spacecraft's active coolant system was compromised, and as a result, the Soyuz is no longer available for operation. It's just my personal opinion, but if it's true, we have a serious issue on the space station because we are missing the crew escape system." Because astronauts aboard the more recent SpaceX Dragon spacecraft don made-to-measure customized suits, those on board the ISS who arrived on the Russian ship would not fit in a SpaceX capsule. Any rescue operation would require another Soyuz. Solo missions to take the lead in rescue. The most likely course of action is for Russia to fly up the upcoming Soyuz spacecraft, which is scheduled to lift off in late February or early March, unmanned, allowing the trapped crew to return in the empty vessel. Scoba, the current president of the International Association for the Advancement of Space Safety, is skeptical that this can be done. "I don't believe the Soyuz is capable of fully autonomous docking. I think at least one person needs to be involved," he stated. If so, Russia would have to send two human spacecraft to the ISS in order to return everyone to Earth. While this is happening, the three astronauts on board the space station must endure several anxious months. The possibility that the ISS could experience a problem at that time and require an evacuation is always a consideration. A Russian satellite destroyed in a missile test came perilously close, forcing two NASA astronauts to postpone their planned spacewalk at the end of November. Thruster rockets had to be fired by the ISS a month earlier to prevent a potential collision with other debris from the same Cosmos 1408 spacecraft. These occurrences serve as an important reminder of the perils of spaceflight. In the Earth's atmosphere, either during takeoff or re-entry, all 19 astronauts lost since 1971 perished. Cautionary tale of risks of space exploration. The most terrifying thought is the possibility of dying alone in space with no chance of being saved. The Apollo 13 mission, which was canceled 50 years ago, came the closest to disaster, even though the 12 men who have stepped on the moon were aware that there is no way back if their equipment fails. After an explosion almost 322,000 kilometers from Earth, the three crew members and NASA's mission control were the only ones who managed to return them in one piece. With new spacecraft and all the associated risks, the Artemis program now pledges to send men back to the lunar surface by 2024. The lunar lander, which offered the three Apollo 13 crew members a life-saving haven on their return trip, will not even be available as backup for Artemis. Separate from the lander, the new Orion spacecraft will reach the moon. They won't connect until they are in lunar orbit. The question of whether a rescue can be achieved is now again on the table, with a rising number of stakeholders in manned spaceflight, including Boeing, Elon Musk's deep space SpaceX Starship, Blue Origin, and Jeff Bezos, the billionaire founder of Amazon. The United Nations created the Outer Space Treaty in 1967, which mandates that astronauts from one state assist those from another if they encounter difficulties in space, but it makes no mention of how. In case of an emergency, NASA placed a backup shuttle on the launch pad when building Skylab, the first U.S. space station in 1973. The crew return vehicle, a lifeboat with enough seats for everyone, was envisioned for the ISS and would be permanently stationed on the space station. However, the project was abandoned after the Challenger and Columbia tragedies raised concerns about the safety of the spacecraft, which was a variant of the space shuttle. Ever since, the Soyuz and Dragon capsules have been used as lifeboats, a setup that has been successful until now. Even though astronauts have long been aware of the risks associated with space travel, the tremendous increase in space tourism, which may soon include actor Tom Cruise, who plans to film a movie on the ISS next year, has raised the possibility of an official rescue service. An article highlighting the in-space rescue capacity gap was released last year by the U.S.-funded space research center, Aerospace. Neither the U.S. government nor commercial spaceflight providers currently have plans in place to conduct a timely rescue of a crew from a distressed spacecraft in low Earth orbit or anywhere in space, the report found. The Journal of Space Safety Engineering published Grant Cates' original analysis last year. Grant Cates, who worked on the space shuttle program and is currently employed at Aerospace, is a writer. The risks involved in space travel are many, and they are magnified by the fact that there are no plans and attendant capabilities in place for the timely rescue of a crew from a disabled spacecraft, he stated. The U.S. has the resources to create and use efficient in-space rescue capabilities, according to Gates, who added that the U.S. is the world's leading spacefaring nation. It's possible that the Dear Moon mission will take off the next year. On a six-day journey that includes a flyover of the moon, nine passengers will board a SpaceX Starship. No regular astronauts will be among them. Only the captain, Yusaku Maezawa, a Japanese billionaire in the fashion retail industry, has traveled in space, and only to visit the ISS. Despite the fact that Dear Moon's stated goals are world peace and creativity, if something goes wrong, it will be known more as the Titanic of the 21st century. And now let's take a closer look at SpaceX's Crew Dragon. The Crew Dragon was created by Elon Musk's SpaceX, principally to transport astronauts to the ISS. It was built as part of NASA's strategy to transition from depending on Russian launches for years to using American businesses for space station flights. According to Elon Musk, his groundbreaking company SpaceX has always had human spaceflight as its primary objective. The billionaire accomplished his goal on Saturday, May 30, 2020, when the Crew Dragon spacecraft launched NASA astronauts Bob Behnken and Doug Hurley into orbit for a rendezvous with the ISS. Since the shuttle's retirement in 2011, it was the first crewed vehicle to take off from U.S. land. So when shuttle program came to an end, NASA had no replacement vehicle available. As a result, the space agency had to rely on Russia to transport American astronauts to the ISS. However, in the meanwhile, Boeing and SpaceX developed vehicles to replace those ones. As of September 2021, Crew Dragon will also be utilized for totally private missions that send amateur astronauts into space, in addition to its current schedule of routine trips to the orbiting station. Musk's spacecraft is an evolution of the Dragon 1 spacecraft, which has launched 20 times on missions to deliver goods to the ISS. Crew Dragon's overview. Musk showcased the 7-seat Crew Dragon design in May 2014 during a gathering at SpaceX's Hawthorne, California headquarters. Its architecture is similar to that of the Apollo Command Modules, which sent humans to the moon. The capsule is connected to a component called the trunk from launch until just before re-entry. The trunk features cargo room, solar panels, heat removal radiators, and fins to maintain stability during emergency aborts. The capsule and trunk measure 4 meters in diameter and stand about 8.1 meters tall together. 16 Draco thrusters on the Crew Dragon are used to control the craft while it is in orbit. In the absence of gravity, each Draco is capable of exerting 90 pounds of force. The capsule is equipped with a launch escape system, which consists of 8 16,000-pound force Super Draco engines in case anything goes wrong during liftoff. Crew Dragon immediately separates from its rocket thanks to the LES. The spacecraft's interior. According to SpaceX engineer John Federspiel, the corporation aimed to make Crew Dragon feel like a spaceship of the 21st century. The touchscreens within Dragon, he says, were intended not just to be incredibly practical, but with a user experience in mind. They're perhaps one of the major features. The cockpits of earlier vehicles, like the space shuttle, had analog buttons and dials, which were a far cry from the 3 sizable touchscreen screens that the commander and pilot used to monitor and control the spacecraft. Hurley and Behnken worked closely with SpaceX to prepare the crew capsule ready for its historic launch in May 2020, as the first individuals designated to ride on Crew Dragon. Both of the crew members, who had previously flown on the shuttle, contributed significantly. Hurley acknowledges that getting adjusted to the touchscreens took some time. "The touchscreen definitely doesn't give you that in terms of true physical feedback," he claims. "What you do get, though, is a return flash on the screen, which lets the astronaut know whether or not the vehicle correctly recognized their input. The touchscreen controls are far more than enough for situations where astronauts might need to take over physical control of the normally autonomous craft, like as concluding a docking process with the space station," Hurley continues. "It just might not be the same thing you'd want to utilize if you were fitted up and trying to fly an entrance or descent, for example, like we could do with the space shuttle," says Behnken. And that ends today's episode. What do you think of this episode? Let us know your thoughts on the comment box below. Please subscribe and don't forget to like today's video. We'll see you in the next video. Thanks for watching.